Ever get that that little phantom sound in your ear, like a tiny, persistent ringing or maybe a buzz? Well, if you have, you're definitely not alone. Turns out something like 50 million adults right here in the US have had tinnitus at some point.
That's a huge number.
It really is. So today we're going deep, doing a full dive into the research around tinnitus, our goal, to pull out the most useful, interesting bits. What it is, what affects it, and importantly, what you might be able to do about it.
Yeah, and it's pretty likely that you listening right now have either dealt with this yourself or, know someone who has. It's just that common.
Exactly.
And researchers have been digging into it. We've looked at, a lot of scientific reviews, pulling together studies on how many people have it, the risk factors, and all sorts of management ideas.
Like what kind of ideas?
Oh, things like cognitive behavioral therapy, CBT, tinnitus retraining therapy, or TRT, sound therapy. Even some more experimental stuff like repetitive transcranial magnetic stimulation, rTMS.
Okay, rTMS sounds intense. But yeah, we're going to try and unpack all that without getting lost in the super technical jargon. Bring the practical stuff to the surface. So let's start big picture. How many people are we really talking about hearing these phantom sounds regularly?
Well, as you said, about 50 million report any tinnitus. But for the frequent kind, like daily stuff, that's estimated around 16 million U.S. adults.
16 million. Wow.
Yeah, it's substantial. It's not some, fringe issue. It's a pretty widespread experience. Really underlines why finding good ways to manage it matters so much.
Absolutely. 16 million. That's a lot of ears ringing. So, who's more likely to experience this? Is it random or are there patterns?
There are definitely patterns. The data shows pretty clearly that the chances go up with age. It seems to peak in the 60 to 69 age group.
Okay, so getting older doesn't help here.
Apparently not for this, no.
Yeah.
About 14.3% in that age bracket report frequent tinnitus. And interestingly, demographics show non-Hispanic white adults seem to report it more often than other groups.
So age, maybe some demographic links. But what about things we might actually have some control over? Lifestyle factors.
Yes, absolutely. The research points to several modifiable risks. For instance, being a former smoker is linked with higher odds.
Right.
Same kind of link shows up for hypertension, high blood pressure,
Okay.
and maybe less surprisingly, loud noise exposure. Big one.
Ah, yeah. The concerts. Work noise.
Exactly. Leisure time noise, firearms, occupational noise.
Yeah.
All significantly increase the odds of frequent tinnitus. It
Oh.
really hammers home the importance of, ear protection.
Makes you think twice about cranking up the headphones, doesn't it?
Yeah.
Or skipping the earplugs when you're doing loud yard work.
Definitely. Simple things, but they could make a difference.
What about other health stuff? Like, does hearing loss itself play a role? Or mental health?
Yeah, there's a clear link. Hearing impairment, especially in the sort of low to mid and the high frequencies, often goes hand in hand with frequent tinnitus.
Cause and effect?
Regent.
Regret theater?
More just together. Based on this data, it's a correlation, not necessarily proof one causes the other directly. And generalized anxiety disorder also shows up as being linked.
Anxiety.
But interestingly, major depressive disorder didn't have that same strong link in the studies we looked at. Again, it's
Yeah.
about things occurring together, not necessarily one triggering the other.
Gotcha. So it's common, linked to age, noise, maybe anxiety. But what is it? Is it always that high-pitched ee sound?
That's the classic soundbite, isn't it? But tinnitus is really just perceiving sound where there's no actual external source making it.
Right. Phantom sound.
Exactly. And for most people, there's no objective test. You can't just measure it with a machine. Diagnosis really comes down to your story, your medical history, how it's affecting you, your sleep, your concentration, that kind of thing.
So it's less about if the sound is there for a doctor to hear and more about how much it's actually, well, bothering you.
Yeah, precisely. And the sound itself, it can vary a lot. People hear ringing, sure, but also buzzing, hissing, clicking, sometimes even a rhythmic pulsing sound.
Right. Pulsing, like in time with your heartbeat.
Sometimes, yeah.
Yeah.
That type, pulsatile tinnitus, often warrants a closer look from a doctor just to rule out any underlying issues with blood vessels or something like that.
Okay, good to know. So if it pulses, definitely get it checked out. But for the other types, how do doctors figure out how much of a problem it is for someone if it's all subjective?
They often use questionnaires, standardized ones like the Tinnitus Handicap Inventory, the THI, or the Tinnitus Functional Index, TFI.
Okay.
These basically ask you a bunch of questions about how the tinnitus impacts different parts of your life, your focus, your mood, your sleep, social situations. It helps put a sort of score on how disruptive it is for you.
Right, turns the annoyance into a number. Makes sense. But what's actually happening in the brain? Why does it start making up sounds?
Well, the leading theory is that for many people, it starts with some change in hearing, maybe even subtle hearing loss. The brain tries to compensate for the reduced input from the ear.
Compensate how?
By sort of turning up its own internal gain, you could say. And this involves changes in activity in various auditory centers, places like the dorsal cochlear nucleus, inferior colliculus, the auditory cortex. Even some non-auditory brain areas get involved.
So the brain's trying to help, but it overshoots.
Kind of. It's often described as maladaptive neuroplasticity. The brain's ability to change and adapt goes a bit haywire, creating this perception of sound that isn't really there.
Yeah.
A sort of rewiring gone slightly wrong.
Rewiring gone wrong. I like that. Paints a picture. Okay, so we know it's common. We know some risks. We have an idea what might be happening in the brain. Now, the big one, what can we actually do about it? What does the research say about managing this?
Right, the management strategies. And it's super important to remember, what works varies a lot from person to person.
No one-size-fits-all cure.
Not yet, unfortunately. But there are approaches that research suggests can help reduce the impact. Let's start with cognitive behavioral therapy, CBT.
Okay, CBT, we hear about that for lots of things. How does it work for tinnitus?
So with tinnitus, CBT isn't really aiming to eliminate the sound itself. The main goal is to change your relationship with the sound.
How so?
It helps you identify and change the negative thought patterns and emotional reactions that the tinnitus triggers. So even if the sound is there, it doesn't cause as much distress or anxiety. You learn to sort of let it be there without letting it take over.
Like learning to tune out a noisy neighbor, maybe. You know they're there, but you stop letting it ruin your day.
That's a pretty good analogy, yeah. And the research. A review combining studies found that CBT seems to reduce the impact of tinnitus on quality of life by the end of the treatment.
How much reduction are we talking?
Using that THI scale we mentioned, the average improvement was around 10.9 points more than in control groups. And generally, a change of about 7 points is considered clinically meaningful, like noticeable in real life.
Okay, so potentially a real noticeable difference.
Potentially, yes. Though it's fair to say the certainty of this evidence was rated as moderate. So more high-quality studies would strengthen that conclusion.
Right. Does it matter how you get the CDT? Like face-to-face versus online? Group versus individual?
That's a great practical question. Based on the reviews we looked at, there wasn't a significant difference found between those methods.
Oh, interesting.
Yeah. Seems like online, face-to-face, group, individual, they all showed similar levels of effectiveness in the studies analyzed. Same goes for who delivers it. Psychologist, audiologist, other trained folks. Didn't seem to make a huge difference in outcomes in these particular studies.
That's actually really good to know. Makes it more accessible, maybe. Any downsides to CBT for tinnitus?
The good news there is that side effects seem to be pretty rare based on the current research.
Okay, so CBT works on our reaction. What about tinnitus retraining therapy, TRT? You mentioned that earlier. How is that different?
TRT comes from a slightly different angle, based more on the neurophysiological model of tinnitus. The core idea is habituation.
Habituation, like getting used to it.
Exactly. Teaching the brain to reclassify the tinnitus signal as something neutral, unimportant, so it doesn't constantly grab your attention or trigger that stress response.
Mm-hmm.
It aims to break that cycle between the sound, your emotional system, and your automatic nervous system reactions.
And how does TRT try to do that?
It usually involves two parts. One is counseling, giving you information, understanding the mechanisms, reducing fear around it. The other is sound therapy, but a specific kind.
Okay.
Using low-level broadband background sound, not loud enough to completely mask the tinnitus, but enough to decrease the contrast between the tinnitus and silence. The idea is to help the brain filter it out over time.
So it's not about drowning it out, but making it less prominent.
Precisely. And some meta-analysis research suggests that TRT, especially when used alongside medication, might lead to a better overall response rate and perhaps a more sustained response at 6 months compared to just using medication alone.
Interesting. So combining approaches might be beneficial there. What about just general sound therapy, like white noise machines or even hearing aids?
Yeah, sound therapy is a broader category. The thinking behind it can be several things. Masking the tinnitus for immediate relief, promoting relaxation, helping with that habituation process we just talked about, or maybe even helping to counteract some of those abnormal brain activity patterns.
So just adding sound to the environment can help in different ways.
That's the idea. And studies have looked at comparing things like hearing aids, which mainly amplify external sounds, versus dedicated sound generators that produce things like white noise or nature sounds.
And what did they find? is one better?
One review comparing them didn't find a significant difference in their effect on tinnitus severity, measured by the THI, over 3, 6, or 12 months.
Huh. So neither was clearly superior.
In that comparison, no. But here's the interesting bit. Using either type of device was associated with clinically significant improvements. So just using some kind of sound enrichment seemed helpful.
Ah, so the key might just be adding helpful sound rather than the specific type of device, at least in that study.
It seems that way. And of course, many people now use combination devices, hearing aids that also have built-in sound generation.
Right. Best of both worlds.
And it's worth remembering, factors like whether you have hearing loss, your levels of anxiety or depression, or just how distressed you are by the tinnitus initially, might play a role in how well sound therapy works for you.
Makes sense. It's all interconnected. Okay, we've covered CBT, TRT, sound therapy. Now let's get back to that futuristic one. rTMS, repetitive transcranial magnetic stimulation. What's the latest there?
Right, rTMS. It's still more in the research realm, but it's being actively explored. It uses magnetic pulses from outside the head to non-invasively stimulate specific brain areas.
Trying to...
What?
Reset the brain circuits involved in tinnitus.
That's a hope, essentially. By targeting areas like the auditory cortex or prefrontal cortex, researchers are trying to modulate that maladaptive brain activity we talked about.
And is it working?
Meta-analyses suggest that active rTMS might be better than a sham or placebo version. Specifically, studies show it may lead to reductions in perceived tinnitus loudness and also improvements in those THI scores, indicating less handicap, at least around 1 month after the treatment ends. These differences were statistically significant.
1 month out sounds. Okay, no. But what about longer term?
That's still a big question. Long-term effects need more investigation. And there are challenges with rTMS research.
Like what?
Well, there's variability in how the stimulation is applied, the frequency, the exact target, the number of sessions. And creating a truly convincing sham or placebo condition is tricky. You need a good placebo to be sure the effects aren't just due to expectation.
Right. The placebo effect is powerful. So promising, but still needs more work.
Definitely. It's an active area of research.
Okay. So we've covered a lot of ground here. CBT, TRT, sound therapy, rTMS. Lots of different approaches being studied. What are the really crucial takeaways for someone listening who's dealing with tinnitus?
I think the first thing is, as we've said, tinnitus is super individual. What helps one person might not help another. There's no single magic bullet yet.
Right. Trial and error might be involved.
It often is. Secondly, while research is ongoing, and we definitely need more high-quality studies, especially looking at long-term effects and comparing different treatments head-to-head, there are strategies that show promise for reducing the impact tinnitus has on your life. It's not necessarily about silence, but about getting back to living well despite the sound.
That's a really important distinction, managing the impact.
Exactly. And we need better research, overall better reporting of potential side effects, using consistent ways to measure outcomes so we can compare studies more easily. Researchers are also digging into nuances like which specific parts of CBT are most helpful.
So for you, the listener, if tinnitus is something that's really bothering you, what's the bottom line?
The bottom line is don't just suffer in silence, ironically enough. Talk to a healthcare professional.
Like who? Your regular doctor.
Your regular doctor is a starting point, but ideally, someone with expertise in hearing and tinnitus, like an audiologist or an ENT ear, nose, and throat specialist, they can do a proper assessment, rule out other causes, and talk you through the management options that might be best suited for your specific situation.
Get that personalized plan. Makes total sense.
Absolutely.
All right. Well, this has been a fascinating deep dive into the buzzing world of tinnitus research. As we wrap up, maybe a final thought for everyone to consider. Given how complex tinnitus is, how tied it seems to be to hearing, brain activity, emotions, how do you think research and treatment might evolve? Could we see a more, I don't know, holistic or personalized approach in the future?
That's a great question to ponder. Moving beyond just targeting the sound to really addressing the whole person and their experience. I think that's likely where the field needs to continue heading.
Food for thought indeed. Well, thank you for exploring all this with us today. If this topic resonates with you, we definitely encourage looking into the resources and maybe talking to a professional. And feel free to reach out if you have more questions. Until next time, keep listening, keep learning.